every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I am so excited to have my guest with me, Michelle Glogovac. Am I saying your name right, Michelle?
You did. It's perfect, Rhonda. Thank you.
Well, I want you to share your purpose and how you found it. Will you do that for us?
Absolutely. Thank you. I'm excited to be here. And, you know, it's funny, I didn't really think about having a purpose of, you know, what am I supposed to be doing until I had my two kids. And they were born back to back, took a long time to have the first one, figured it would be the same for the second. Nope. Boom, she came a year and 3 weeks later. Oh. And for 18 years, I sold jet fuel to corporate flight departments. And I was basically saving the rich money so they could continue flying around the world. And it was fun. I met interesting people and celebrities. But when I was laid off and I had two little ones at home, I thought, what is it that I can do that makes the world a better place for them? Because helping the wealthy save money so they can continue flying isn't really having an impact in a positive way for their future. And I really struggled with, what am I going to do? What can I do? And a woman from my first birthing class said, there's a life and business coach who's launching a podcast. I think you might enjoy it. You should listen. And in 2018, I said, how do I listen to a podcast? How do we do this? I know they've been around for a while, but I didn't know how. Well, I had an iPhone. It was the purple button that allowed me to listen to this woman who was saying, we all have a purpose and a passion in life. And I went, yep, I don't know what mine is, but yes, I'm going to keep listening because I need to figure this out. And I was posting about it on my social media that I was on this journey of figuring out, what am I meant to do? What can I do? I want to still make an income, but I want to make an impact as well. And she reached out to me and said, do you want to pitch me to be on podcasts? Because obviously my content resonates with you. And I went, this is a thing? Yes. And so I learned everything there was about podcasting, producing, pitching, and I fell in love with the pitching part because podcasts are free for the most part, and they are on a topic for everyone on everything, whether you want to be entertained, educated, you want to hear about someone's life story, someone who's in the same path that you're currently in, and, you know, to find that hope at the end of the tunnel. It's the perfect avenue and platform for all of this. And I went, I can make lives changed one voice at a time by simply helping people share their stories. And so that is what I do. My agency pitches clients to be on podcasts, but there's more to it. You know, I work with the clients on their stories and what their goals are and making sure that everything aligns, and then taking their interviews and repurposing them to greater marketing content. But that is my purpose, is to help change lives through podcasts.
Wow. Excuse me. Wow, that is so awesome. So you're helping people share their stories,
mm-hmm.
and really articulate in a concise and meaningful way.
Yes.
To people through podcasts.
Wow. Yeah. Whether it's their stories or their education that they've learned, you know, people launching businesses and what are the tips and tools that you can share and how did you come up with these things? You know, there's always a story behind all of it. And I really feel if you go into a podcast interview wanting to inspire, motivate, educate, and let people know, you know, your story, then ultimately they're going to fall in love with you and want to know what your service, your product, your book is. But if you go with that positive intent in the first place, then they feel that and they hear it. And so they'll want to get to know you more, which is why I tell my clients, don't go in selling whatever it is. So this is not our platform to go sell your product or your service. Go share yourself. Mm-hmm. And the rest will fall into place. And that is what I believe in and what I practice.
Oh, Michelle, that's really, really good. I think you're absolutely correct. I know that when I've heard anybody, not just on podcasts, just anywhere, you know, if it's just all self-promotion, I'm just, you know, I don't know, kind of tune it out.
It's cringy.
Yeah, cringy. That's a whole new, there's a whole new vocabulary out there that sprouted up. Cringy is one of those words. But so I'm curious to know, so how does it make you feel, or how did it change your life to really start living this purpose, as opposed to how you felt back in the days of selling jet fuel?
You know, it's like those times where you hear people say, you know, what makes you want to get out of bed in the morning? And I truly love what I do. I am excited to come to sit at my desk. I don't have to drive anywhere. I just walk a few feet down the hall. But I am excited to sit here and do what I do. I look forward to every client that I speak to, all of the podcasts that we're connecting to. It simply makes me happy. And I know that in the feedback we receive, clients receive and share of, you know, so-and-so reached out to me and they couldn't believe my story and it changed their mind on, you know, whatever it is. Or, oh, they told me that they're no longer feeling alone. They're going through the same thing. Or clients who get a job promotion because of it, or they land more clients because they're sharing their story. Simply, it makes you feel good. You know, it makes you feel good about what you're doing and how you can help others.
Yeah. Yeah. I love it. So I'm curious to know, one of the things that I hear from people pretty regularly is, you know, I don't know what my purpose is, and I don't know how to find it. And that's, you know, I can understand that's a common thing. And many of us, you know, take a job when we're young and we wind up in that industry. That's what happened to me. Mm-hmm. You know, we wind up being in that industry forever, and it's hard to make the leap. So what advice would you give to somebody who's like, they want to make the leap, but they don't know the first step. They don't, you know, they just are afraid, you know, really, I guess, of taking a leap, leaving a job, you know, and having things not work out. So what advice would you give to somebody in that kind of position?
I wouldn't say go quit your job today. I would say take some time every day and dabble in whatever it is that interests you. You know, if there is something you love to volunteer with or an organization that you're interested in, then take some time to go focus on that. Because even finding those little chunks of time that make you happy, it's going to change the other parts of your life too. So, you know, not everybody has the luxury of quitting their job to go full focus on what their purpose is. But if you can carve out some time to focus on it, to do it, and to exercise that want and that need to fulfill your purpose, then start there. And, you know, you never know how it's going to snowball. That, you know, I was dabbling, I was laid off, so I didn't really have a choice. I had to figure it out. But I was also doing things on the side. You know, I did some social media management. I did some event planning, because these were all things that I also did in my last career with aviation regional groups and stuff like that. And I found right away that this isn't what I don't enjoy doing it. Like, I knew it. And so I would stick with something, you know, make some money because there's still mouths to feed and a house to pay for, while figuring it out. What is it that I want to do? How can I continue on this path? And I used to work very long hours when I launched the business, because that's what I had to do. You know, there's so much, especially when you're launching a business, and that's for your purpose of, you know, how much do I charge? How many hours do I work? How do I find my clients? So there's a learning curve in all of it. And, you know, that can be scary as well. But I think if you apply yourself just in small amounts of time to figure it all out, it'll all come into play. You know, the big picture will reveal itself at some point. But if you can't quit your job, then don't quit your job, but make some time on the weekends or in the afternoons, you know, to do what it is that fulfills you and makes you feel like you are using your purpose and fulfilling that.
Okay. So if I'm hearing you right, you're talking about dabbling. I love that word because, you know, that's, I think, how we find out what's not our purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So by process of elimination, you basically, if I heard you right, you just said that, you know, you try some different things, and if you don't love it, that's probably not part of your purpose.
Right.
But when you find that thing that feels really fulfilling, it feels really good, it's a pretty good sign that has something to do with your purpose.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So then the next question is, how do you make a business out of it? Like, how did you make a business out of it? And so do you, I'm assuming people pay you.
Yes.
To prepare them and to pitch for them. And so how did that work? I mean, did you, was it word of mouth? Did you grow your business that way? Or did you advertise? I'm just curious to know, because I think this is that turning your thing that you care about, you're passionate about, the thing you want to do, actually turning it into a business and making it work for you financially is one of the biggest things to overcome. So yeah, if you don't mind sharing that, I think people would really be interested in that.
Yeah. So when I figured out that podcasts were my thing, I dove headfirst into what does it take to create a podcast from beginning to end? What goes into it? I took a course on podcast management. I looked at editing. I realized I didn't like editing. So I've never done the editing part. I have good friends that are editors that I can hand any of that off to. But then I started producing shows and doing pitching as well. But that's when I also realized I don't really love the production part. I don't like that every Tuesday we have an episode that goes and a certain host will tell you on Monday night at 8 p.m., oh yeah, I forgot, here it is. Can you make it go live at 5 in the morning? I went, this isn't really my thing. This is taking away from the part where I wanted also that freedom and flexibility to be at home with my kids. Working late at night was not doing it for me. And the pitching part I really loved. And I've been able to, over the years, figure out and align that I stayed in aviation for 18 years, not because of the jets or the fuel, but because of the people. I loved the relationships I had made with so many of the people in flight departments that I've continued on 20 years later, that, you know, I knew birthdays and anniversaries and what's going on in whose life and what their favorite food or favorite wine was. And that's what helps me in my job today, is that I do the same thing with my clients. I know what's going on in their lives. I know their story, whether or not there are parts that we're revealing to the world. I know everything that there is to it and to them in order to pitch them, because I want to be their biggest fan. When I send a pitch, it is because I love who I work with. And it was in figuring that out. And in the beginning, I'll be honest with you, I charged $100 a month to pitch clients. And there was someone who said, I bet you could get $250. And I went, oh, okay, that would be great. But $250 a month for the amount of work I was putting in, it was crazy. And so I started to do more research on what do other agencies who are similar to mine do? What are they charging? And then I would take what their service offering was and I went, well, you know what? I can do all of this and I can add on this and I can add on this and give an even bigger offering. So let me slowly creep up my prices. And that's what I did. And now, no, it's not $250. It's between $2,000 and $2,500 a month. And that's how I've made it become a business that has been successful for myself, for my family. And it's always in offering more and servicing clients in a bigger and better way than what I feel others are doing, because I want them to find value in it. And that's how I've been able to turn it all into a business. It's all been referrals. I've never advertised. I haven't done cold calls. It's been word of mouth, whether it's from podcast hosts who have received my pitches or clients who are like, yes, you love what I'm doing here. This is who's doing it for me. It's all been referral based for 5 years.
That's awesome. Good for you.
Thank you.
I love it. I love that you're living your purpose. Although I have to say, Michelle, the math doesn't add up. If you were selling jet fuel for 18 years and you've been doing this for 5 years and you look like you're 21.
You are too kind.
My math is just not adding up at all.
No, and I have a 7 and an 8-year-old, and then I have stepkids that are 20, almost 25 and 21. So no.
Oh my gosh. And when you're with them, everybody thinks that you're one of them, I'm sure.
No, I don't think so. You are very sweet. We must have some filters.
No, I was thinking whatever you use on your face, I need a gallon of it, girl, right
away. There's nothing. Some moisturizer, maybe some CC cream, and that is it.
Gosh. Okay. Well, I just, I think what happens when people are living their purpose, they just look happier.
Yeah.
And they,
I believe that.
Right. I mean, it's so interesting to me how the conversations that I've had with people who really are fully immersed in their purpose, in living their purpose, you can tell they're more joyful. They're more cheerful, calm. They're calm, not stressed out all the time. It doesn't mean that there's not stress, and it doesn't mean that there aren't, you know, challenging things that happen. There are. But I think when we're in the sweet middle of our purpose, the thing that we were really made to do, we're better able to handle the challenges of life.
Yeah, definitely. And I've been told, oh, when you talk about it, you light up. And it's because I do. I truly love what I do. And, you know, I know that sounds corny to some, and it sounds corny to me sometimes when I'm like, I love what I do and I like you. And, you know, but I truly mean it. You know, one of the words that I hate the most is the word authentic. You have to show up as your authentic self and be authentic. And I go, you know, if you just were you, then you don't have to try to be authentic. Just be who you are, say what you say, you know, and then the rest will come naturally. But if you have to be authentic, then you're not really being yourself.
Oh, that's really interesting. I have to say, I'm one of the people who says, be authentic, be your most authentic self. And I say it all the time. And I think it's because, Michelle, women in particular, maybe men too, but I've only ever been a woman, so I only know. So I feel like a lot of us, and I don't know, maybe it's my generation, I don't know, but you feel like you have to be a certain way in the workplace. You have to be a certain way with your in-laws. You have to be a certain way in your neighborhood. You have to be a certain way in, you know, at church. And you have to be a certain way. Name the different groups that we go to. And I know when I was my CEO of my national company, and I was Ms. Large and in charge, wearing a black Armani suit to everything, just looked like I was just ready to, you know, kick some butt and take some names all the time. And so when I was in that role, it's like I was playing a role. It was an authentic aspect of me, but I didn't dare to show weakness. And I didn't, there were certain things, like I didn't want to share my personal story because it would make me too vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, being a certain way here and a certain way there, I wasn't putting on, I wasn't being phony, but I was only revealing certain aspects of my personality in certain places, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I found that after selling my company and starting to write books and, you know, the different things that I do, my level of peace and joy blew up. I mean, exponentially, when I felt like, okay, I can really just be congruent. I can show whatever aspect of my personality in every situation.
Yes.
When it's called for.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
And so I think that's where, for me anyway, that's where I come from when I'm saying be authentic, because we know that, you know, if somebody's in a workplace where, you know, they have a difficult boss and, you know, that they have to constrain their authentic personality.
Mm-hmm.
And some things are frowned upon and, you know, don't be making jokes and, you know, whatever it is. And for me, if you're in that kind of a situation where you really can't fully be yourself, I think that's probably a pretty good clue that you're probably not in the sweet middle of your purpose.
Absolutely. And it's exhausting because you don't get to be yourself in all of these different places. And, you know, that fear of, well, what if I say the wrong thing because this isn't the right audience for it? Or I can't cry because, you know, oh, it might be frowned upon or looked at as a weakness. And it shouldn't be that way. I feel that if we all were just to show up as we are and accept each other and to hear each other's stories, you know, it's going to build more empathy in the world. And to know what you've been through and for me to share what I've been through and, you know, what others have been through. And that this is why I love podcasts in general, because we get that opportunity to hear from others. And it also brings about that, you know, it can be that you get to hear from someone that you wouldn't normally hear from. And so it breaks that barrier as well, that someone can show up as their true selves in a conversation with another human being that the rest of us get to eavesdrop on.
Wow, that's a fun way to put that. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think if we all did more of that, then, you know, we wouldn't have to worry about authenticity because we are just simply being ourselves. Because we're all accepting of each other, including ourselves. We accept ourselves for who we are and aren't afraid of, you know, who am I going to upset by saying something, or, you know, who is going to frown upon me showing up this way or dressed this way. The world has a lot of work to work on.
Oh, isn't that the truth? Yeah. Yeah. I love what you said. Yeah. About that, because it seems like in a lot of places nowadays, we sort of have to walk on eggshells. And that's, you said exhausting. It is. It's exhausting. Mm-hmm. And there's sort of an intimacy, I think, to a podcast, like a conversation that other people get to eavesdrop in. I hadn't thought of it that way, but it kind of is, because I'm not worried about walking on eggshells here.
Right.
And I think I do try, because I'm an old lady.
You are not an old lady.
I really am. I'm old. Like I'm from a whole other generation where, like, I see you have your pronouns there. And every time I go to put my name someplace and it says, what are your pronouns? I'm like, I'm not going to tell you my pronouns. Because I think it ought to be obvious that, you know, I'm just me, and I don't know. There's certain things I'm just like, okay, come on. I don't want to engage in anything that doesn't unify people. I don't want to divvy people up into little groups. I don't think about the color of people's skin or their ethnicity or their economic status, or, you know what I mean? I just want to know you as a human being. And I want to connect on some shared experience. And it, you know, I founded Successful Survivors Foundation. It's a nonprofit organization. It's all about encouraging, educating, and empowering survivors of childhood trauma. And so abuse, abandonment, trafficking, you name it. And I found that when you connect with somebody on a shared experience that might have been a traumatic experience, a difficult experience, you aren't talking about the weather. You're
right.
Not talking about the score from last night's game. You're just not, you just go to a deeper level. right off the bat. And I think that's, for me, that's the way I want to live. And so, but in the world, there are lots of places where, you know, somebody's going to get all ticked off because I don't want to name my pronouns and that, you know, and that I don't, just the way I look at the world and the way I look at other people, and I couldn't care less what somebody looks like or dresses like or how much money they have in the bank. Like, I'm just not impressed by the things that our culture is impressed by. Mm-hmm. But I am impressed by resilience and fortitude and resourcefulness and courage and bravery and tenacity and determination and all the character traits that it took for you to start a new business from scratch. And not just a new business. It's like, it wasn't a franchise where there was a book with rules that tell you exactly what to do. Like, you had to make it up as you went along.
And yeah, podcasting is still the wild, wild west. Right? Yes.
I mean, and so not only just podcasting, I mean, I don't mean to diminish podcasting, but it's not like you just started a podcast. You are all in with helping people do their podcasts and get on podcasts and share their story. I love that. It's like you created your own thing, your own niche, your own space in the world. And there's nothing wrong with somebody buying a franchise. Let me just throw that in. I mean, that's great too. If that's your purpose, you rock it on. But that's where I connect with people is, yeah, you know, in understanding, okay, what have you survived and what's your purpose and are you living it? And if not, why not? Let's blast through objections and you've done it. So I'm so glad.
Thank you. You
shared that with me today.
Thank you. I love being able to share that, and hopefully it resonates with someone that you can start small, get big, and you know, enjoy what you do every single day that you wake up.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Okay. So Michelle, if somebody wants to contact you, to have you help them start a podcast or get on other podcasts or all of the above, how do they contact you?
My website's the MLGcollective.com. I also have my personal website, MichelleGlogovac.com, and I'm on all of the social media platforms. And I also have my first book, How to Get on Podcasts, will launch January 11th with McGraw-Hill. So that is the easiest way to also figure out how to get on podcasts, but you can connect with me and I'll walk you through it all.
Oh my gosh, that is so awesome. So I just want to make sure I heard you right. The MLGcollective.com.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for joining me today. And so for all of our listeners, I hope that you've been encouraged by listening to Michelle's story of how she found her purpose. And it's not lost on me, Michelle, that you found your purpose at a time when you'd been laid off.
Mm-hmm.
So many people find themselves in some kind of a transition, you know, going through a divorce or the loss of a job or the death of a loved one. And the idea that, you know, it wasn't easy and
right,
you did it and you stuck with it and you made it work. And now you're successfully living your purpose. That is beautiful.
Thank you.
Very encouraging to a lot of people.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
All right. Well, thanks again. And check back with me next week. All of Michelle's information will be in the show notes. And we'll see you soon.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.